upstanding figure, and then on top of all their politics, get their Christianity correct. What you want is someone to uphold the Constitution and respect your freedoms is what you want. Now, do you know this? Once I found this out, I thought, well, who's surprised? Governor Glenn Youngkin is an Anglican. He's not a Christian. Going to the Mormon temple, going to the Interfaith Day, going to the Baptist, whatever. He's an Anglican. Trinity Group owns the land at 850 Balls Hill Road in McLean, Virginia. That's home to the Holy Trinity Church, the Episcopalian Church, where Youngkin serves as a warden. He's an Anglican, he's the governor, and he signed in homosexuality to state law when previous Democrat governors did not even do it. Now, here's what I want to do. Let's look at Holy Trinity Church. If you go to their website, you might, and so you do that, and someone says, well, wait a minute. Holy Trinity Church is a Christ-centered, non-denominational church. You can't call him an Anglican. So wait a minute. I have to pause so everybody like sees what we're doing. You might say, well, tonight's broadcast hasn't had so much Bible. Well, we're having a thinking exercise here, okay? Glenn Youngkin campaigns and he seduces all the religious evangelical sectarians of Virginia, and they all just say, oh, the moral vote, and they give it to him, and then he betrays them. Well, if you do this and you start looking and you look beyond just surface, he goes to Holy Trinity Church in McLean, Virginia. Someone says, well, that's a non-denominational church, Caleb. I figured you would like that. Non-denominational. I thought you'd like it. Let's look at their statement of faith. Heritage. What is it? Let me go back. Holy Trinity Church, the Episcopalian Church where the Youngkin serves as a warden. Well, they call themselves non-denominational on their website. We're going to get statement of faith coming up. Look at this. HTC, Holy Trinity Church, is an independent, non-denominational church rooted in the teachings and traditions of the Church of England. You're actually not that non-denominational after all. And then it goes on in this next paragraph, we pursue biblical orthodoxy, confessing the historic faith of the Christian church as expressed in the Nicene and Apostles' Creed and the 39 Articles of the Church of England. Oh, how about that? I'm not surprised at all that he would basically sign it. Even after, I'm saying, how many years after 2015, when none of the Democrat governors touched it, Glenn Youngkin comes along and he signs it into law. And all the Republicans, they, oh, we're betrayed and we just can't believe it. He's an Anglican. Look, this is their statement of faith. Let's scroll down even further. They're quote, non-denominational, but not really. They're the Church of England. They're Anglicans. They subscribe to 39 Articles of the Church of England. But you go down and look at this. More statement of faith. The Trinity, God the Father, Jesus the Son, Holy Spirit, about the Bible, angels, Satan, about humanity, marriage, and leadership. Now let's look at this. Okay. This is Glenn Youngkin's church statement of faith. Holy Trinity, they're Anglican. We believe both the image and roles of men and women flow from the essence of God's Trinitarian identity. There is a mutual submission within the Trinity, even though there are differing roles within the Trinity. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are equally and fully God, but each with different roles. Jesus submits to the Father, and the Holy Spirit submits to both the Father and Jesus. We believe both Adam and Eve were created in God's image, being equal before God as persons, and that the role distinction within biblical manhood and womanhood were ordained by God as part of his creation before the fall, and they were not a result of sin. We believe both the Old Testament and the New Testament reveal the equally high value and dignity created by God in the distinct roles of men and women within marriage. We equally value and encourage both women and men in leadership roles within our church. That marriage and leadership was more about Trinity. We got way more information about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And then you just start talking about they're made in the image of God. They're not saying to you that they won't marry a man and a woman. And then right after they talk to you about what marriage, like it's got the word marriage, distinct roles of men and women within marriage, that does not say that it's for man and woman only. And then it says we equally value and encourage both women and men in leadership roles within our church. This is the same thing that everybody's running into, and this isn't rocket science. Look, if you're going to ignore 1 Timothy chapter 3, that the bishop must be the husband of one wife, and you guys start ordaining women bishops, and you start putting women into the preaching roles and the pastor role of any of y'all's denominations and sects, if you're going to ignore this, then the homosexuals are going to come along and they're going to say, look, we just get to ignore Matthew 19:4, that marriage is for male and female. We're ignoring that. Homosexuals are going to say they are ignoring that as much as anybody else gets to ignore that men do the teaching and the preaching in the Lord's church. I'm not surprised. I didn't always know he was an Anglican, but once I found he was an Anglican, I said, I get it. And, someone said, boy, you're Virginian, and you come in and beat up on the Republican governor. Look, Ben Carson ran, I think in 2016, he was running for the presidential office, and he was running as a Republican. Mitt Romney, 2012, I didn't vote for him, didn't vote in 2012 at all. And he's running as a Republican, Mormon. Anglican, Ben Carson, Seventh-day Adventist. Anglican, Seventh-day Adventist, and a Mormon. All three of them, their religion is equally worthless. Man-made. He's a Virginian who's still holding on to European sectarianism. Seventh-day Adventist is just off the wall. Everybody counts Seventh-day Adventist as off the wall. Mary Baker Eddy, Ellen G. White. Ellen G. White is a Seventh-day Adventist, and Mary Baker Eddy is Christian Science. I always have to say them out loud so that I can arrange them in my own. And then he's following Joseph Smith, who obviously, the Book of Mormon, Doctrine and Covenants, Pearl of Great Price. You got Glenn Youngkin signing in homosexual to the state Virginia law. Mitt Romney's book, Doctrine and Covenants 132, says that polygamy's okay. See what I'm saying? I don't think he's moral. I'm not a Seventh-day, I'm not an Anglican. I don't trust these people just because they're ringing a Republican bell. And if you do, you're out of your mind. Now, you go back, and I'm saying none of y'all, really and truly, hardly very few people even discuss the Constitution when they start talking about their vote. It's like, well, what am I going to get out of this? And, you know, is he basically some type of religious Bible thumper? These dudes don't read the Bible. He reads Ellen G. White material. He reads Joseph Smith material. And they read the Book of Common Prayer. So, no, I'm not shocked. So, here's my question. Do you read your Bible? We just had everyone that went to church one time a year to look at the resurrection. Do you ever read the crucifixion story and the resurrection story, and you're pulling for Herod and Pilate? They're gonna come in and they're gonna save Jesus. No. When Pilate heard of Galilee, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And as soon as he knew that he belonged under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod. So what was Pilate doing? He's doing what politicians do. He's passing the buck. Oh, this dude belongs to a whole other jurisdiction. Get him out of here. Don't put this on me. Put him in Herod's realm. No, I've never read Luke 23 and thought maybe Pilate would save the day. I've never read Luke 23 and thought Herod would save the day. Then I don't know why we're waiting on presidents to save the day. Do you know who saves the day? Number one, Jesus. And Jesus left the earth, and what did he leave behind? He left the church to do what? Be salt and light, Matthew 5, in the community. You're not going to save the world with politics. You are going to save individuals with the gospel. It is unbelievable. Let's look at this. Ephesians 3:10. Let me go out of that. Oh, it's right there. Here's Ephesians 3:9. To make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto heavenly principalities and powers and heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. The church is the education dispenser in the world. Moral practices, the rules of marriage, the Good evening, everybody. My name is Caleb Robertson. I am a Christian. I'm a member of the body of Christ. And the body of Christ is the one church that you will read about in your New Testament. This broadcast is called What Does the Bible Say? And what we're trying to do is get people thinking about religion. Y'all, we have a load of religious people. They're not doing any thinking. Folk are on autopilot, okay? On the Sundays that they do go to worship, they're not thinking. They're not investigating. And here's the other thing. What does the Bible say? We have people right now, and their denomination, like their traditions, they are drastically changing, and everyone's scratching their head. You know what? The Bible didn't change. So I don't know how it is that all these people have their changes going on. I'm saying, Pentecostals are vastly different than they used to be. They used to not allow women preachers, now they do. And independent fundamental Baptists are all about getting the Holy Ghost way more than they used to be. Independent fundamental Baptists now look Pentecostal. And of course, the United Methodist sect is imploding with their LGBT problems. It's really not a problem. The Bible's very clear about homosexuality. So we have all this division that's going on. It's horrible. We don't want to be divided. We should all just be Christians. We should all just be reading our Bible. You don't need the Anglican's Book of Common Prayer. This is the King James Bible. You don't need the Anglican Book of Common Prayer. You don't need Presbyterian's Westminster Confession, any of that. We should all just be Christians. Okay. I shouldn't need that. I'm just letting you know. We should all just be Christians. We should all just be members of the body of Christ, the one church in the New Testament. Now, here's, as I say all that division, and I already talked about Pentecostals, Baptists, Episcopalians, and Presbyterians, I want to ask you this question. Are any of you church-going folk thinking about atheists and how we need to convert them into Christians? I don't want to turn an atheist into a Baptist. There's not a Baptist church in your New Testament. I want to take atheists and I want to make them become Bible-believing disciples of Christ. Do you want, this is Richard Dawkins. He is one of the most famous atheists alive right now. And he is aging out, right? So he's aging out. But he has been one of the most prominent, loudest atheists. And he is very antagonistic to the Bible and God. And so I say this about this question. Do you care about atheists? Do you actively say, yes, I want atheists to become believers in the Christ? And here's my point about having all this, the Roman Catholic sect. We cannot afford, if you care about atheists, skeptics, agnostics, then we cannot afford to continue to look foolish in front of them. Now, look, I'm a Christian, and I believe the Bible. I'm a student of the Bible. There is no Easter bunny in your New Testament. If you're looking at Acts chapter 12, the word Easter that we have in the King James Version, that word Easter is translated from the Greek word Pascha. In Acts chapter 12, they were in the middle of a Jewish Passover feast. There is no bunny in the Bible. There are no eggs in the Bible. And it makes zero sense how the Roman Catholic sect got all of us hooked up with eggs and a bunny and convinced us that we can come to worship one time a year. That is incredibly foolish in front of Richard Dawkins. Now, here's why I'm even talking about Richard Dawkins tonight, y'all. So here's my thing. I want to take Baptists, and I want to convince them with the Bible that there is no Baptist church in the Bible. You guys are not, you're not pledging your allegiance to the Bible, because when y'all make decisions as Southern Baptists, you appeal to the Southern Baptist Faith and Message 2000. So I want to take Baptist folk, and I want to convert them into being just Christians. I want to take Methodists, and I want them to stop being Methodists and become Christians, just Christians. No annual discipline, no foreign hierarchy system. We don't need Roman Catholics. We don't need Rome telling any other country what to do as far as their religion. We have the Bible. We can read the Bible. We can follow the Bible. So Roman Catholics need to become converted to Christians. See what I'm saying? Just Christians, one church, multiple local congregations. No one's saying that we can't have local congregations. But when you read the Bible, the church at Corinth was the same church at Ephesus, right? Look, this is the opportunity that is in front of us. We have massive massive opportunity right now to make headway for the cause of Christ only if we will abandon sectarianism, division, and tradition, and simply get back to the Bible, then we can make headway. Listen to Richard Dawkins. Richard Dawkins, one of the most world-famous atheists, and listen to what he says about Christianity. This is what? This is from 9 days ago. Listen to this.
For example, we lost all our cathedrals and our beautiful parish churches. So I count myself a cultural Christian. I think it would matter.
Role in national life. Welcome to LBC.
Thank you.
And what would be your Easter message? I've said a few things. What would you tell the nation?
Well, I must say I was slightly horrified to hear that Ramadan is being promoted instead. I do think that we are culturally a Christian country. I call myself a cultural Christian. I'm not a believer. But there's a distinction between being a believing Christian and being a cultural Christian. And so, you know, I love hymns and Christmas carols, and I sort of feel at home in the Christian ethos. I feel that we are a Christian country in that sense. It's true that statistically the number of people who actually believe in Christianity is going down, and I'm happy with that. But I would not be happy if, for example, we lost all our cathedrals and our beautiful parish churches. So I count myself a cultural Christian. I think it would matter if we, certainly if we substituted any alternative religion, that would be truly dreadful.
Well, which brings me to my supplementary point, which is that, as we know, church attendance is plummeting, but the building, the erection of...
Play more, but I do want to pause. Did you hear Richard Dawkins just say, if we substituted Christianity for any other religion, he said it would be absolutely dreadful. Now, y'all, Richard Dawkins is known for basically having this massive tirade where he uses a load of adjectives against God. He calls God an egomaniac, masochistic, just bully. He just has this long list that he came up with, and he has all these negative attributes that why he hates God. And what's he now saying? Oh, well, now that England is just being invaded by Muslims and mosques are popping up everywhere, suddenly Richard Dawkins is a cultural Christian, and he loves Christianity. If we didn't have Christianity and switched it out for something else, he said it'd be absolutely dreadful. Listen to what he says more.
Mosques across Europe, I think 6,000 are under construction, and there are many more, are being planned. So do you regard that as a problem? Do you think that matters?
Yes, I do, really. I mean, I have to choose my words carefully. I mean, if I had to choose between Christianity and Islam, I'd choose Christianity every single time. I mean, it seems to me to be a fundamentally decent religion.
Richard Dawkins is now saying that Christianity is a fundamentally decent religion. he just said a moment ago he's not a believer. He's still not a believer in Jesus the Christ. If we're not going to acknowledge that this man is absolutely changing his tune, we are out of our minds. Now, what we need to do is we need to buckle down and get serious, and we need to line up and say what he's saying about Islam is absolutely true. I have zero sympathy for Islam. Muslims are my spiritual enemy. Philippians chapter 1, verse number 18. Paul said that there are enemies of the cross. Muslims do not believe in Jesus the Christ. No, no. And so he's saying it would be absolutely dreadful.
In a way that I think Islam is not.
I think you're going to have to explain why you say that, Professor Dawkins. Why is Islam fundamentally not decent like Christianity?
Yes, I mean, the way women are treated. I mean, Christianity is not great about that. It's had its problems with female vicars and female bishops and things. But there's an active hostility to women, which is promoted, I think, by the holy books of Islam. I'm not talking about individual Muslims who...
Let me do this. Let me go to Richard Dawkins' historical comment on, like I'm saying, this is older Richard Dawkins from back when. Listen to what he says about Islam.
In America and Europe, I'm pessimistic about the Islamic world. I regard Islam as one of the great evils in the world. And I fear that we have a very difficult struggle there.
Why is it more problematic than Christianity, for instance?
There's a belief that every word of the Quran is literally true, and it is... there's a kind of closed-mindedness there, which is I think, less present in the former Christendom, perhaps mm-hmm. because we've had long, I don't know quite why, but there's more of a historical tradition of questioning.
Historically, Richard Dawkins has very much, he said, I call Islam one of the biggest threats to the world. So what we all have right now, and as I'm saying, I'm a Christian, I believe the Bible, and I think that we all, if you're going to call yourself a believer in the Bible, you need to get serious. And I have to say this right now too. If you are a Methodist and a Baptist, a Presbyterian, you don't really believe the Bible. Oh, how can Caleb say that? Well, the way that I can say that is because if I asked you to show me the Methodist sect or the Baptist sect or the Presbyterian sect in the New Testament, could you do it? No, there's no one in the New Testament calling themselves Methodist, Baptist, or Presbyterian. So you're not even following the Bible. And then that's where you say, well, we recognize, like, we're denominations. Division in the Bible is not accepted. Jesus said, every house divided against itself, every kingdom divided against itself will not stand. So Jesus was not for the division. And in John chapter 17, verses 20 and 21, Jesus prayed to the Father that we all might be one. So you don't get to have this thing where you say, well, I mean, we all recognize that we got denominations, but we're all believers. No, if you're in a denomination, you're not following the Bible. Because if you were reading your Bible, you would see that Jesus wants us to be collectively one. And we're not collectively one. Roman Catholics view everybody else as Protestants. And if you sprinkle babies, then all Southern Baptists reject you as a pedo Baptist. Is there anything I need to do? Like, do I need to restart my OBS?
We may end up doing that.
Okay.
Joey's still working on some things.
Okay. And so, like, I have no slide progression at the moment.
Gotcha.
So anything else, like, moving forward, I got nothing. So as we have all this opportunity, this is where I was going to say, you know, in that moment, you might be new to what does the Bible say. And normally on a Wednesday night, you're seeing my dad, Johnny Robertson. I will say this. When we have these quotations, restart? Okay. Can you put up any type of screen for me, or am I just going restart like a type of delay?
I think I can put up.
Okay, here I come. My thing just reopened OBS,
okay.
And now Now, as I was saying, you're accustomed on a Wednesday night on Whig TV to seeing my dad, Johnny Robertson, and sometimes you might say, well, you guys are cycling through these scriptures so fast, I can't keep up. I'll try to let everybody be at a keep up pace, but I do want to say this. You know, maybe it's not that my dad and I go so fast. It might be that at your church, they don't actually teach so much Bible. And so you're not accustomed to actually following along through biblical thought. You might just be accustomed to hearing, like, some of the pastor is going to get up and tell y'all stories about his kid going to see the Easter Bunny at the mall. You know, so you're going to have to keep up. Now, I want to say this really quickly, too. Someone says, what you got the president in there for? Because the president's a Roman Catholic. That's the Roman Pope. So don't get bent out of shape because I put the president up there. I'm talking about everybody tonight. Richard Dawkins, I care about Richard Dawkins. I want Richard Dawkins to become a Christian so that he can die and go to heaven. Right? You want folk to go to heaven, which means you're going to have to evangelize to folk, which means you're going to have to talk to strangers, which means you are going to have an argument with somebody. Richard Dawkins doesn't care if you have an argument with him. I'm talking about Billy Graham tonight. I'm talking about Geno Jennings, one in the Godhead Apostolic, and I'm talking about Jerry Falwell Sr., one of the biggest preachers in the Southern Baptist sect out of Lynchburg, Virginia. Now, if you're watching this broadcast and you say, look, I want to get more info on what these guys are trying to do, my phone number is 276-806-3641. My email address is calebgrobertson@gmail.com. Every Sunday morning, we put out a page and a half Bible article. If you email me, we'll put you on the informer list. You'll get this in your email inbox. And then this is what the broadcast looks like on YouTube. So you're watching it in Rocky Mount, North Carolina, but your cousin Ted over in Wisconsin, if he's got any type of smart device that can connect to YouTube, he can see what does the Bible say. Purple white banner, that's my dad's photo in the Watch Live icon. Now, we can't afford to look foolish in front of the atheists. You're watching on Whig TV. This is what it looked like on your smartphone. Let me say this really quickly. If you're watching on Whig TV before What Does the Bible Say come on tonight, I'm Caleb Robertson. That's my dad, Johnny Robertson. If you're watching this broadcast right now, and before I came on, you were watching John Shannon preach out of Memphis, Tennessee, and you said, I liked what I was hearing from John Shannon. Let me tell you, John Shannon is my brother in Christ. John Shannon is just a Christian. John Shannon is a member of the body of Christ, and John Shannon only pledges his allegiance to the New Testament text. He does not abide by creed books, and neither do I. So if you like that, then you love What Does the Bible Say, because we are teaching the same gospel as Brother Shannon out of Memphis, Tennessee. Someone says, is this like they got their headquarters in Memphis, Tennessee? I don't have headquarters anywhere on earth. The head of the church is Jesus the Christ. He's in heaven. So if you ask me where my headquarters are, they're in heaven. He is a brother. He's not some apostle like Geno Jennings. This is a man who needs Jesus. He's just a minister. He's just a brother. And you don't have to call me pastor. I'm not a pastor. I'm just a Christian. And I just want to talk to you tonight about the Bible, and I want to be serious. Now, I got to tell you this. Sometimes I ask you that question as we got started. Do you care about the atheists? Do you have concern about what happens to people as far as heaven or hell? This man, like, you look at that's his body. But people are souls. So when, like, you're looking at me, this is just my vehicle. I'm in here, okay? Do you care about what happens to me in here? Living and dying, eternity. I care about the man, Richard Dawkins. And I care about young men who are atheistic or they're agnostic. I don't doubt you when you say, hey man, I had a really bad religious experience. What you need to say is you went to some particular sect and you had one bad experience over there. That has nothing to do with Jesus. That has nothing to do with God or the Bible. Now, I do have to say this. I want to work on your thinking. I'm not at all some type of traditionalist, okay? I don't just toe a party line. Sometimes I have more in common with Richard Dawkins than I do any of these sectarians. I'm not a Roman Catholic. I'm not an Episcopalian. Episcopalian is the Church of England. I don't do that. I'm not a Methodist. I'm not a Wesleyan. I'm not a Baptist. I'm not a Pentecostal. I'm not Apostolic. I'm not a Jehovah's Witness. I'm not Seventh-day Adventist. I am just a Christian, and I just subscribe to the Bible. But look at this. You know, the Roman Catholics, they claim to believe God. they don't follow the Bible. So you got Richard Dawkins out here saying the biblical text is not authoritative. But then you look around at Roman Catholics and they just don't care what the Bible says. Do you know what the Roman Catholics call their priests? Bless me, Father, I have sinned. You're talking to a man in a wooden box and he sins. Who do the priests confess their sins to? Fellow priests? No way. I'm not calling these men Father. My Father, Matthew 6, verse number 9, is in heaven. I don't need, and the Pope basically just stands for Pope is Papa. He's not my Papa. Again, Pope Francis is a man who sins, who is in need of the blood of Christ. So, Matthew 23, 9, you got some Roman Catholic relatives. Do you want to change them? Do you want them to become Christians and stop being traditional Roman Catholics? You know, you guys call your priest Father. You know, Jesus explicitly said, don't do that. You guys call the Pope Papa. He's like your spiritual father. You know, Jesus explicitly said, don't do that. This is where we are. Richard Dawkins, sure, he falls into the Psalm 14, verse number 1. The fool hath said in his heart, there's no God. But American sectarians fall into Luke 6, 46. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? You say, well, yeah, I mean, I care about Richard Dawkins. I want him to go to heaven. You're not going to heaven. You don't follow the Bible. You are just a traditional American sectarian who happens to sit in a building on Sunday morning. You're not a Christian. You can call it what you want. He called himself a cultural Christian. Well, you can be a cultural Christian with him, but you're not a real Christian. This is what I want Richard Dawkins to be on. This is what God wants for Richard Dawkins. 2 Timothy 3, verse number 16. Do you believe the Bible is inspired? Oh, yes. The Bible is the Word of God. We got some really good books out here, right? We got some great literature in the world, but it's not inspired, right? And we got a bunch of documents that men came up with that are pretty good, but they're not without contradiction. The Bible is inspired, and the Bible is without contradiction. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, instruction, and righteousness. 2 Timothy 3, verse number 16. Acts 17, 1, 2 and 3. Paul, as his manner was, went into them 3 Sabbath days, reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, which I preach unto you, is Christ. So what do I want for Richard Dawkins? He said, Richard Dawkins said on some English broadcast, if we had, instead of Christianity, he said, if we got any other religion, it would be dreadful. Richard Dawkins said, Christianity is a fundamentally decent religion. He needs to subscribe to Scripture, and he needs to believe that Jesus is the Christ, and he needs to be baptized into Christ. Now, get serious, okay? This is Lakeside Baptist Church in Rocky Mount, North Carolina, and they will never, ever convert an atheist. They are what's called, I told you I'm talking about everybody, right? I got Billy Graham coming up, I got Jerry Falwell coming up, I got Geno Jennings coming up. None of them are Christians. And this woman preacher over at Lakeside Baptist Church, her name is Miss Edwards. Miss Edwards is not a Christian. She is an American sectarian. She is a co-op Baptist. And co-op Baptists are the most liberal branch of the Baptist sect. Look at this. I say, look, do you care? Do you even believe in eternity? Do you want any atheist to become a Christian and spend eternity with the saved and the Lord? I do. I still believe in heaven, okay? I still believe that the Bible is authoritative. And I think that the Bible not only is authoritative, it's understandable. So when we come to these passages, Miss Edwards is going to say, well, you know, first century culture, no. She's going to try to muddy the waters. She's going to try to turn all this into a gray area. Look, I'm married to a woman, okay? I love women. I love my woman. My mama is a woman. I love my mama. My sister is a woman. I love my sister. My mammy is a woman. I love my mammy. My aunts, women, okay? Don't give me this business about male chauvinism. The Bible, as an authoritative text, says that men are in leadership of the church and women do not get to do the public teaching over a mixed assembly. This is in your Bible, okay? This is 1 Corinthians. This is the Bible. This is in your Bible. Let your women keep silence in the churches. It is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also says the law. Let me have a moment. Do you know why I don't take that? Well, this was first century culture nonsense. I don't take that off of anybody. You know why? Because when Paul in the first century wrote this text, he also based it off of the law of Moses. He said, what I'm saying to you right now off of inspiration of the Spirit, he said, the law says the same thing. Well, the law isn't first century culture. That's 1,500 years prior to the first century. And look, and it's not, well, you know, different cultures as far as geography goes. Corinth is different. 1 Timothy is written to the church in Ephesus. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Paul says, let your women learn in silence with all subjection. I suffer not a woman to teach nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. So if Miss Edwards ever got a chance to talk to Richard Dawkins and she said, Richard Dawkins, you need to put your faith in Christ. You need to be baptized into Christ. You need to become a Christian. Richard Dawkins would turn back around to her and say, you're not about to proselytize me. You don't even believe your own text. This woman cannot convert any skeptic, atheist, or agnostic into anything except for being a co-op Baptist. Look at this. This is the bio of Lakeside. At its founding, Lakeside was affiliated with the Southern Baptist Convention and the Baptist State Convention in North Carolina. Because of the National Convention's turn toward fundamentalism, the congregation removed itself from the affiliation with SBC in 2000 with the Baptist State Convention in North Carolina in 2006. We support both the Co-op Baptist Fellowship and the Alliance of Baptists, which are moderate, forward-looking mission service organizations. The split that happened in the 1980s, the Co-op Baptists were birthed in the 1980s when they split from the Southern Baptist Convention. And the reasons, two reasons that they split in the 1980s was they no longer believed that the Bible was inspired by God and they wanted women preachers. She's not converting anybody. And you know what? Neither is Geno Jennings. Because if Geno Jennings got an opportunity to talk to Richard Dawkins and Geno got with Richard Dawkins, he said, Mr. Dawkins, you need to become a believer in the Christ. You need to be baptized into Christ. You know what Richard Dawkins is going to say back to him? He's going to say, Geno, you don't even believe your own scriptures. Why is it that Pentecostals and apostolics are always hounding people to get the Holy Ghost? And when you get the Holy Ghost, how is it manifested? In the American Pentecostal sect, do you know how the Holy Ghost is always manifested? By the speaking in tongues. You know, there's more spiritual gifts in the New Testament than speaking in tongues, but somehow that's what every Pentecostal gets. Every Pentecostal speaks in tongues. And you know what they never have present? They never have an interpreter present. Paul, the Apostle Paul, in the authoritative text for Christians, the New Testament, if any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two or at the most by three, and that by course let one interpret. But if there be no interpreter, let him keep silence in the church and let him speak to himself and to God. Now here's my thing. Any Pentecostal who would stick with the Bible against women preachers, if Geno Jennings looked over at these passages and said, the Bible said to keep silent in the church if you're a woman. Well, the Bible also said for tongue speakers to keep silent in the church if they don't have an interpreter, and y'all never have an interpreter, which means what? Y'all should never be speaking in tongues. Geno Jennings will never convert an atheist. And you know what? Put both of them together, both of them confused. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. Let all things be done decently and in order. 1 Corinthians 14, 33 and verse number 40. Now, I believe that. We've all got the same Bible. How is it that we are coming away with astronomically different interpretations? Look, there's not an interpretation to this. This is a rule, and that's it. If you're claiming to speak in tongues, but you don't have an interpreter, you don't get to speak in tongues. There's no interpretation to that. There's no deep-seated theology. That's a rule. If you don't have an interpreter, you don't get to speak in tongues, and they never have an interpreter. Look, if you are a woman, you do not get to preach in the assembly. What's so bad about that? There are loads of men who don't do public teaching. They can go out and evangelize. They can make disciples. But they're not preaching in the Sunday morning assembly. What's wrong with that? Now, I will say this. In the Virginia, and I'm saying Reidsville, North Carolina area, my dad, Johnny Robertson, was debating on television with a local atheist. And this atheist had a master's degree in physics. He was one of the local school teachers. And this atheist would come on television and he would admit, go back to this slide, his name was Larry Serber. And Larry Serber, as an atheist, would read his Bible and he would look at what religious folk did. And Larry Serber said himself, with a master's degree in physics, Larry Serber said, these Pentecostals who never had an interpreter, Larry Serber said that was one of the biggest turnoffs. He said, that's how I knew Pentecostals were wrong. They're always speaking in tongues, never have an interpreter. An atheist may not believe in the Bible, and that's not good. They're not stupid. They might just be uninformed about what the Bible is really saying. Some people are atheists, and they've never read the Bible. They may not be nearly as informed on science as they think they are, and they might just be dishonest. You know, there are some people that will just be dishonest, but I'm not coming to a conversation with any atheist and just saying, look, man, you're just so stupid, there's no way you're going to get it. Right now, they just don't believe, and I think they can be changed. But these folk ain't going to change them, because Gino is not keeping the Bible any more than she is in the co-op Baptist sect. Now, here again, you know, I had this on a broadcast recently. Did you see, you know, he didn't have to do it, but President Biden is a Roman Catholic, and he didn't have to acknowledge on March 31st, he didn't have to, quote, recognize Transgender Awareness Day, but he did. And that's why I say he didn't have to do it as the president. He certainly should not have done it as a Roman Catholic. And so that's a moment where I then again say, look, I got more in common with Richard Dawkins on that one than I do President Biden. Listen to Richard Dawkins.
What they call degender and neutralize language. But they're doing it from a completely false pretext that you can somehow pretend biology doesn't exist, particularly when it comes to someone's sex. I mean, it's incontrovertible. There's no scientific doubt about this. And yet a small group of people have been quite successful, actually, in reshaping vast swathes of the way society talks and is allowed to talk.
It's bullying. And we've seen the way J.K. Rowling has been bullied, Kathleen Stock has been bullied. They've stood up to it. But it's very upsetting the way this tiny minority of people has managed to capture the discourse and to really talk arrant nonsense.
What's the answer to it?
Science. I mean, there are two sexes. You could talk about...
That's it. Richard Dawkins says, no, there's only two sexes. You're a male or you're a female. And you can't swap. And you know, the Bible said that. That wasn't some new revelation from Richard Dawkins. Matthew 19:4 has been in the Bible for 2,000 years. Have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? If there's any man-made sect out here that's not going to stand on that, look, there's just two sexes. There's a man and a woman. But here's the problem. What we've got right now is we have a load of religious people, and they'll say, oh yeah, there's a man and a woman. But they won't abide by what the New Testament says about gender roles in the New Testament church. Men are bishops. Men are deacons. Men are elders. But you do not have women pastors. So we have a load of people who would say, oh, well, there's only two sexes. But then ask them if women can preach. They don't believe the Bible. And they're never going to convert an atheist or an agnostic, because the atheist and the agnostic will probably know the Bible better than they do, and they're going to catch them in all their inconsistencies. Here's another one. Why is it that Richard Dawkins, as an atheist, will admit that Islam is just horrible? And Billy Graham, the most famous Southern Baptist preacher that ever lived, will not say that.
But what about those faiths, the Mormons and the others that you mentioned, believe in Christ? They believe they will meet Christ. What about those like the Jews, the Muslims, who don't believe as
That's
you believe?
That's in God's hands. I can't be the judge.
You don't judge them?
No. No,
how do you feel
you're
when
going to hell? And you're, well, but as I got older, I guess I became more mellow.
No, and you know, I said earlier, let me go to Philippians chapter 1. Okay, I said Philippians 1:18. It's Philippians 3:18. I said earlier, and then it went away. Philippians 3:18. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. I don't hate anybody. Like people who are total strangers, how could I hate you? I don't even know who you are. I disagree. I have opponents, okay? And Muslims are my spiritual opponents. Jews are my spiritual opponents. Do I hate Jews? No. Am I saying that any American citizen who wants to practice, you know, Judaism and go to a synagogue doesn't have the American right to do it? Absolutely, they have the American right to do it. That's their First Amendment right. They're not correct in their theology. They are absolutely rejecting Jesus of Nazareth. Someone says, well, do you think they're saved? No. What do you want me to say? If you're going to ask me, Caleb, do you believe in the Bible? Yes. Do you subscribe to the New Testament? Yes. Then how could I possibly say that Jews are saved? They do not recognize Jesus of Nazareth as the Messiah. They're, in Acts 4:12, the apostles, hand-selected by Jesus, this is Peter, the Apostle Peter said, there is no other salvation in any, there is salvation, neither is there salvation in any other name. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. So if there's just one name as a means of reconciliation to the Father, then how can I think that the Jews are saved? Well, they reject Jesus. Same thing for Muslims. Muslims don't believe that Jesus is the Christ. Now, can you believe Billy Graham? He just said, I'm not going to judge them. That's where Richard Dawkins would say to Billy Graham, you ought to. Your own text regularly talks about people who reject Jesus the Christ. What did Jesus say to people who rejected him? Look at John 3, verse number 18. John chapter 3, verse number 18. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. All I'm doing is quoting. Someone says, well, you're speaking in place of Jesus. No, this is literally Jesus speaking for Jesus. He that does not believe is condemned already. Billy Graham is not going to convert an atheist or an agnostic with this easy believism, watered down Southern Baptist tradition. See, like I said, I'm talking about everybody. Because everybody needs to get their act together. I talked about Miss Edwards. What is it, Lakeside? Lakeside Baptist Church, Rocky Mountain, North Carolina. She's a co-op Baptist. We have co-op Baptists where we are in Martinsville, Virginia, and they're the worst church in town. You know, they're a sect. They're not the church of the Lord. This is Libby Grammer. She's a co-op Baptist. She's a, quote, woman pastor. That's unbiblical. But what she did in 2023, and boy, you talk about in bad taste. Bad taste. This is called First Baptist in Martinsville, Virginia. And in 2023, on June 25th, they hosted an Interfaith Day where Libby Grammer invited a Jewish woman, Martha Woody, and a Muslim man, Muhammad Ali, I don't know how to say his last name, but he's Muslim. And she invited these people to come to her pulpit and talk about how they don't believe that Jesus is the Christ. She rejects Jesus as the Christ. He rejects Jesus as the Christ. She is an agent of the devil. If you're inviting people to teach against Jesus, what else could I say? You're certainly not an agent of the Lord. And you're never going, and why I said bad taste? June 25th, 2023, weeks later, you had Muslims attacking Israel. Boy, you talk about in bad taste. And here they are, Muslim with the Jews, while you have Muslims attacking Israel. They don't get along. Who are we kidding? Who is she kidding? Nobody. And she said, our community is made better by engaging in dialogue with those of other faiths. Well, if you read your Bible, there's only one faith in Ephesians chapter 4. I'm not interfaith by any means. There's one body, one spirit, even as you're called, and one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith. I am not interfaith. I am a Christian. There is one body, one church when you read in the New Testament, and it is not co-op Baptist, not any type of Baptist. It's crazy that y'all just can't even agree with the Bible right now. Richard Dawkins, he says the Book of Mormon is wrong. There's loads of religious people that they won't even say that. Listen to Richard Dawkins.
People give when you ask them why they become religious. They palpably show that they don't actually know any science. I mean, many of them say, for example, oh, how could you not be religious when you look at the beauty of a tree or a bird or a kangaroo? I mean, how could that just come about by chance? Well, of course it doesn't come about by chance. It comes about by evolution, by natural selection. And that's an explicable and explained and understood process. But a lot of people don't realize that it's understood.
Isn't it also, when you listen to Brandon here explaining what's for him the beauty of religion, the beauty of believing, isn't this a profound need we have, like a genetic need?
I think there may well be a profound need to understand. And the satisfaction that you get from genuine understanding, which comes from science, is so much greater. I mean, there is far more beauty in a real understanding of the reality of nature than there is in reading some ancient book, or than reading some modern book, which is what the Book of Mormon is. And I have to say that when I read the Book of Mormon recently, I didn't read it all, what impressed me was that it's an obvious fake. I mean, this is a 19th century book written in 16th century English, and it came to pass, verily I say unto you, and things like that. That's not the way people talked in the 19th century. It's a fake. So it's not beautiful. It's a work of charlatanry.
You're free to answer.
The book's been studied and torn apart and looked at. And I'm not one of the professors that have done it.
Yeah. But do you believe?
And for you to call this man a charlatan, I do. I take offense to it.
But he was a convicted charlatan. No, he was a convicted con man.
No, these are all falsehoods. You should do your research.
Well, I think I have.
Bring me back.
Yeah, you have.
These are all falsehoods. You should do your.
In case you don't know, he's a rock star. Okay, that's the lead singer for the Killers. I get it. Like someone says, you know, you can't put Richard Dawkins up against a rock star. Richard Dawkins was correct. The American government had Joseph Smith on the run out of a place called Nauvoo, Illinois. Joseph Smith had absolutely set up camp in Nauvoo, Illinois, where they were practicing full-blown polygamy, and the American government got them on the run, and that's how they ended up in Independence, Missouri. They were fleeing the American government. So when Richard Dawkins says a convicted charlatan, he's absolutely right. Now, he's a rock star. He doesn't know what he's talking about. But that part where he said the book has been torn apart, the Book of Mormon has been torn apart, and it has been found totally fictitious. Joseph Smith talked about how he translated his Book of Mormon off of golden plates. We have no evidence. Nothing archaeological finds, no archaeological finds for these golden plates attached to the Book of Mormon. You know, the Book of Mormon talks about its own separate style of coinage, currency, right? In the Book of Alma, it has its own style of currency. Do you know there's zero archaeological evidence for that currency? He's a rock star. He didn't know what he was talking about. But here's my thing. I don't understand why the trained religious scholars can't be so bold as what Richard Dawkins said. The Book of Mormon is absolutely fictitious, and it's nonsense that it was written in the 1900s as a 1600 document. It's a total fabrication from a con artist. Absolutely. But you know what? Roman Catholics are blindly following the Roman Pope as much as any Mormon ever blindly followed Joseph Smith. Y'all are not going to turn agnostics, atheists, skeptics into believers. You got, basically what you'll get is maybe some people wander in. You marry, a lot of people marry into religion, and most people are just born into their religion. Here I am, I'm a Christian, and I'm going through and I'm reviewing the sects, the sectarian groups, and I'm saying, look, this atheist has got them on the ropes. But then there's this, what? There's this disconnect in Richard Dawkins. He says, I am a cultural Christian. I enjoy hymns and Christmas carols. And he said, if we tore down all the church buildings and the cathedrals, he said, I would miss them. He said, if we replace Christianity with Islam, it would be dreadful. And then he goes on, he says, Christianity's is a fundamentally decent religion. Yes, Matthew 5, Jesus told his disciples, he said, you're the salt of the earth, you're the light of the world. Individuals who really follow the Bible, they're the salt of the earth, man. That's what Jesus said. And Richard Dawkins picks it up. You know, real Christians are fantastic people. And then he says this part. We didn't hear it, but I'm telling you, there's a quote in there where he said, well, Christianity is not synonymous with American fundamentalism. He's absolutely right. Christianity is not an American religion. Christianity is meant for the salvation of any worldwide individual. In the book of Revelation, it says this, I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, and tongue, and people. Now, let me go over here to another atheist, Christopher Hitchens. This is a moment with Jerry Falwell. I am not a supporter of Jerry Falwell. Okay? I am not with Thomas Road Baptist sect. Nope, not at all. I do not subscribe to Baptist tradition. Baptist tradition is not found in the New Testament. So this is an old news clip from when? I don't know, back in like 2007 when Jerry Falwell Sr. died. And this is what Christopher Hitchens said when Jerry Falwell died.
15 additional years and he got it. Well, I'm praying the same prayer with an option to renew.
And do you think you'll get it?
I don't know.
Christian Almanpour talking to the Reverend Jerry Falwell several months ago, hoping for more years on his life. Reverend Falwell, of course, died today after a life of faith and controversy. We've heard many voices in the last hour and a half discussing Falwell's life and his legacy. Here on 360, we believe in giving all sides a chance to air their views. You, the viewer, can come to your own conclusions. In a moment, we'll hear from Franklin Graham, the son of Billy Graham, who has fond memories of Jerry Falwell as a friend and a pastor. First, a very different point of view, though, a representation of another. Christopher, I'm not sure if you believe in heaven, but if you do, do you think Jerry Falwell is in it?
No, and I think it's a pity there isn't a hell for him to go to.
What is it about?
No, and I think...
I'm not sure if you believe in heaven, but if you do, do you think Jerry Falwell is in it?
No, and I think it's a pity there isn't a hell for him to go to.
Jerry Falwell is... Christopher, I'm not sure if you believe in heaven, but if you do, do you think Jerry Falwell is in it?
No, and I think it's a pity there isn't a hell for him to go to.
You know what I say to that? I say that folk need to toughen up. Do y'all know how many people Jerry Falwell put in hell? And then a bunch of old women started clutching their pearls because Christopher Hitchens says, I don't believe in heaven, but I think it's a pity that there's not a hell for him to go to. Christopher Hitchens later died. He's not saved. He's an atheist. He doesn't believe in Jesus as the Christ. He's not saved. Christopher Hitchens says, I don't believe in heaven, but it's a pity there isn't a hell for Jerry Falwell to go to. Do you know how many people Jerry Falwell put in hell? You cannot be upset for this man voicing what he thinks while Jerry Falwell, and this is what I'm saying, I don't want Jerry Falwell to be the American Pope any more than I want Francis to be the Roman Pope. This man is not my Christ, not my Messiah, and neither is Billy Graham. And I don't want some national convention with a national religious president. I'm fine with having a national president of, I'm saying, like the state that protects the constitutions, but as far as his theological janglings, no, I don't want that. Here's why I say we got to get serious, y'all, and you got to stop being so sensitive. I've had Jehovah's Witnesses in my house tell me I'm... The funny thing is that Jehovah's Witnesses don't even believe in hell, and they tell me I'm lost. But when they told me they thought I wasn't saved, I said, look, dude, I'm not mad. I don't think you're saved. Now, you're going to have to stop being so sensitive. We're going to have to be able to meet each other in conversation, and I'm saying, y'all, we are going to have to be honest enough, and we're going to have to want freedom enough, and I'm saying in religion, that we are going to all agree, look, truth is going to pin down falsehoods, and we're not going to hold back. Richard Dawkins says, in that video where he calls himself a cultural Christian, he says, the idea that creation happened 6,000 years ago and that Jesus was born of a virgin and raised from the dead, he still calls that nonsense. But y'all, who can blame him when the same people that are telling him Jesus was born of a virgin and raised from the dead are the same people who are promoting the Easter Bunny, they're promoting the Easter eggs, they're promoting Santa Claus to their kids? I don't fault Richard Dawkins at all for thinking that religious people are idiots. Superstitious as all get out. Look, y'all, I was having dinner with a Roman Catholic years ago, and the Roman Catholic told me about, wasn't a homeowner, and he said, I'll tell you how to sell your house. He said, you go out there and buy the real estate sign in your house, on your yard. He said, you take a figurine of St. Joseph, you put him upside down in the dirt next to your real estate sign. He said, and you make sure he's facing to the street and you bury him back over. He said, you'll sell your house. Superstition. And then you want to try to like sell to Richard Dawkins? No way. Now, here's where we are right now. We got just a couple minutes and we'll wrap up, y'all. Richard Dawkins likes the culture. He doesn't like the beliefs. Well, you can't, Richard, you can't have the culture without the beliefs. This is a very, very common college textbook. It's called The Churching of America, 1776 to 2005, Winners and Losers in Our Religious Economy. You will find this used in a number of college history courses, and this is their take on it. Let me get out of the way. As denominations have modernized their doctrines and embraced temporal values, they have gone into decline. The message becomes worldly and is held with less certainty as religion becomes focus of scholarly critique and attention. They begin to lift restrictions on behavior and they soften doctrines that had served to set apart from social environment. You cannot have the Christian culture without the Christian beliefs. And that's all that he's, like he says, I don't want the beliefs, but I sure do enjoy the culture. He said, it's a fundamentally decent religion. He said, if you replace Christianity with Islam, he said, it would be dreadful. Well, he doesn't want the beliefs. And this college textbook is going to tell you, you can't have the culture without the beliefs. And so here's where we are, y'all. You got to start thinking this way. Worship is non-negotiable. No. We're not even going to have a conversation about it. We are going to keep the commands of God the way the apostles gave them to us. Caleb, my aunt said she wants to be a preacher. Too bad. The collection of all of us who believe the Bible, we are not going to take a knee to your aunt or your grandma. Paul said this, I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in all things. He says, and you keep the ordinances as I delivered them to you. If we're keeping them as they were delivered, we don't get to make alterations. 2 Thessalonians 3, verse number 6, we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother that walks disorderly and not after the tradition which he received of us from the apostles. The Greek word for ordinance is the same Greek word for tradition. Look, if I am going to be withdrawn from for walking disorderly, then that means the command, the ordinance, the tradition, it is set in stone. And when I deviate from it, I'm the problem. That's what 2 Thessalonians 3:6 says. You keep the ordinances as they've been delivered. Anybody who deviates from the tradition that was received from the apostles is to be withdrawn from. There is no discussion about it. We're going to have to get that serious or we will lose the opportunity that's on a platter right in front of us. Richard Dawkins just told everybody that Christianity is a fundamentally decent religion. John 4, 23-24, do you have to go to church in order to go to heaven? 100% you do. This is what Jesus said. The hour comes and now is when the true worshiper shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeks such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Look, let me just tell you. In spirit and in truth. That does not mean roll on the floor, jump over the pews, hoot and holler. I don't have a problem with worshiping with enthusiasm. But 1 Corinthians 14:40, we're going to keep it decent and in order. And decent and in order doesn't have to mean you're at a funeral. Okay? Look. If you don't want to come to worship, don't come. You shouldn't have any expectation to see the Lord. In a 7-day period, you had one time where you were commanded to come together with Christians and worship God, and you didn't want to do it. And somehow you say, but I do want to see him later on when I want that reward. Not happening. Do you have to go to church in order to go to heaven? Yes, you do, right there. And you know what? Well, Caleb, give him some bending. No, I'm not giving him any bending, because what we've done is we've given people an inch and they took 500 miles. And they Co-op Baptist took all that bending room and they came back and said, hey guys, we decided the Bible's not even inspired. Look what you did with all that bend. It's no discussion on it. Matthew 26:26-28, they were eating. Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples, said, take, eat, this is my body. He took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink you all of it, for this is the blood of the New Testament, which is shed for the many, the remission of sins. Through the Bible, take the Lord's Supper every Sunday. You know why? Because Easter Sunday. Every Sunday, I am thankful for the death and the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. And every Sunday, I memorialize his body and his blood. Well, the text doesn't tell us to do it every Sunday. Look at 1 Corinthians 16:2. Every Sunday, I make a monetary contribution, and it's not a tithe either. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of... Look, I give more than a tithe. A tithe is a 10%, and I give more than 10%. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God has prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. Now, this verse doesn't say every first day of the week, but somehow pastors have decided, now every Sunday we're going to collect the money. Then why are we not remembering the Lord's death every Sunday? Hebrews 7:5, did that point make sense? Your pastor takes money every Sunday on the first day of the week. Well, they were breaking bread, Acts 20, verse number 7, on the first day of the week, but y'all don't think that means every Sunday for breaking bread, but money means every Sunday. You're inconsistent, and the atheists are going to get you. Hebrews 7:5, the tithing is an Old Testament command, and I'm not a Hebrew. I don't have any Levitical priesthood to give to. I'm not under the law of Moses, Hebrews 7:5. Now, when they got done taking the feast with the bread and the fruit of the vine with Jesus, they went out and they sung a hymn. Colossians 3:16, I sing with my brethren to do what? Teach and admonish. The Lord's Supper is wrapped up in the thinking of my inner man. The singing of these songs are wrapped up in the admonition and the education of my inner man. When I make my contribution, it has to do with reflecting on God blessing me. Do you know why worship is non-negotiable? No discussion, because if we don't worship something, we all will become our own God. And to quote Richard Dawkins, that would be dreadful. Because that when you knew God, you glorified him not as God, and they changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into the image of beasts and man. You have to fixate your thinking on somebody and worship them. Otherwise, you will become your own director. And everybody has their own director, and their own little g God does not work for mankind. Now, you got to get serious, y'all. This is what does the Bible say. This is my dad, Johnny Robertson. My name is Caleb Robertson. We are Christians. We are members of the Church of Christ. And we want you to study your Bible, and we want you to become Christians only, members of the body of Christ. Here's our contact info. We love you. God bless you. Keep asking, what does the Bible say?